As Tim mentioned, Jesus has been healing and teaching in the area of Gennesaret, and people have come from all over to be healed, and even the scribes and the Pharisees have followed him. Now follows our this morning. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting at us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. These are the words of life. Thanks be to God.
This is a particularly difficult passage, I think, and so I'm going to do something I don't normally do. Now, every week when I'm preparing a sermon, I always read many commentaries and those kinds of things, but I want to give some particular credit to the commentaries I read this week. The writings of David Luce and Jaewon Lee and Thomas McAnally were particularly helpful to me this week, and I want to say that because I'm going to be using some of their words, and I want to give them credit for that. But anyway, let's think about this scripture for a minute, because it goes by quick, and you might have missed some things. So we're in the 15th chapter of Matthew, and we see Jesus doing something that surprises a lot of us, and it surprises me because he's doing something that I was taught was always kind of a Pharisee thing to do, and we think of Jesus as being not like the Pharisees. The Pharisees, of course, loved tradition, and they had a strict adherence to Scripture and Torah laws. And here, Jesus seems to love those things too, maybe even more than the woman who's standing in front of him. He goes into these Gentile cities, and if you're new to that term, that means they're not Jewish cities. And a Canaanite woman begs Jesus to help her daughter. And Jesus' response is succinct. Well, first he says nothing, right? And he just lets these disciples talk, and that never gets them very far. So Jesus does eventually respond, and he basically says, No, I wasn't sent here for Gentiles. In fact, in verse 24, he says, "I was only sent to the lost sheep of Israel." Now, this shouldn't be surprising. This echoes something that Jesus has said earlier in Matthew. In chapter 10, he's just called all of his disciples together. And in verse 5 of that chapter, it says, "These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." So he seems to really think he has only work to do with the Israelites. And this woman is not one. She's Canaanite. But she doesn't let up, right? In fact, she makes everyone even more uncomfortable by continuing to shout. And she's not just shouting in public, but she's breaking down all kinds of rules about gender and religion and ethnicity, that she shouldn't be approaching Jesus in public, and she shouldn't be talking to him really at all. But she does anyway. And then she falls to her knees and she says, "Lord, help me." And Jesus' response is the same. Maybe he thinks she doesn't understand because he uses an analogy. He says, "It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." He doesn't feel responsible for her, or at least he believes her to be outside of his purview at the moment. But she retorts, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." And surprisingly to this, Jesus says, "Woman, great is your faith." And he heals her daughter. Now, what just happened? Jesus went from equivocating, blessing this woman, to giving a child's food to a dog. And then he calls her faithful. Now, some people, when they read this scripture, they believe that Jesus knew all along what was going to happen. People who read the scripture this way believe that Jesus didn't really mean what he said about only coming for the house of Israel, that he wasn't really only there for a certain group of people, that all of this was just a test, a way of bringing out the faith or coaxing out the faith of this woman that God had already planted in her. And that's possible, I think. But there's another possibility. It's also possible that Jesus' own sense of the kingdom is challenged and stretched and enlightened by his encounter with this fierce and faithful woman. It's possible, I think, that Jesus really did believe he was only sent to the Israelites, and that this woman with her questions and her pain and her persistence persuades him to see that God is at work in more places than maybe his humanness allowed him to see at first. Now, I know this possibility can seem a little dangerous, because if Jesus can be taught, then he doesn't know everything. And what does that mean? That means he can change. What does that mean? Does that mean he isn't perfect? He isn't omnipotent? And I'm not sure we can answer all those questions within this excerpt, but I do think that this passage invites us to imagine that part of Jesus' life and ministry was to live out God's mission by example. And so perhaps it's imperative to God's mission that those who follow Christ not be ashamed to lay down tradition and learn something new. That maybe that is what God is doing through Christ by example, showing us that learning something is a good thing. Perhaps it's imperative for those who follow Christ to see that Christ can be changed by an encounter that makes him uncomfortable, by an encounter that makes all the disciples uncomfortable. And that makes me wonder if I'm willing to do the same. I hope so, because I think miraculous things happen when God's people honestly examine comfort and tradition and decide to lay those things aside for God to be at work. It revolutionized Jesus' ministry. Now, I can't be certain whether or not it was this particular encounter with this woman, but we know that in chapter 10 and here in chapter 15, he says he's only come for the house of Israel. But by the end of Matthew, when he gives his disciples what we call the Great Commission, do any of you know what he says in the Great Commission? "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." Now, something has taken place in him between here and there. His ministry, his life, heaven and earth are different because he was willing to listen, to let go, to be changed. About 1,700 years later, a similar metamorphosis also revolutionized John Wesley's ministry. Now, John Wesley is the founder of the Methodist movement, for those of you who don't know. And it's hard to describe him briefly, and I have so many stories I love to share about him. But what I'll say now is that he was a man with a very strong sense of what was proper. So when a friend of his named George Whitefield invited him to preach out in an open field, John was indignant. Preaching happens inside the church. That's where it's supposed to happen. But George had become quite popular as a what they called a field preacher, and he started to gain this little following, and at the same time he was gaining the following, George really felt like he wanted to become a missionary in America. But he didn't want to leave this following behind without a leader, and so he was trying to talk John Wesley into taking over, preaching out in the open field to all these people who had started coming out. And finally, after much to-do, John submits to seeing this field preaching done, and he goes to see George preach in person. And he wrote in his journal afterward, this is a direct quote, "I could scarce reconcile myself at first to this strange way of preaching in the fields, of which he sent me an example on Sunday, having been all my life, till very lately, so tenacious of every point relating to decency and order, that I should have thought the saving of souls almost a sin if it had not been done in a church." The next day, Wesley lets himself go. He preaches the Sermon on the Mount out in the open air. And then he later writes that the Sermon on the Mount was an example of field preaching, and how had he never thought of that before? And so he starts to get a little bit comfortable with this. And then he really lets go. He says 2 days later, "At 4 p.m, I submitted to be more vile and proclaimed in the highways the glad tidings of salvation." He became so engrossed with this new way of preaching that in 1742, 7 years after his father has died, his dad was also a preacher, Wesley goes and visits Epworth, where his dad was the minister and where he himself had grown up. And he offers to preach in the church, in his home church. And they refused to let him speak because he had gotten a reputation at this point of being an excitable anarchist, just preaching out in the open field. And so they say, "No, John, you can't preach here. You get the people all stirred up." And so he waits until the church service ends, and then he preached to a large crowd from his father's tombstone in the churchyard, writing afterward, "Never did I preach better than from my father's grave." That's what this picture is of. See John Wesley there in the black? He's standing on his father. He's standing on his dad's grave to all these people who've gathered around him. This was a huge step for someone so established in church tradition. He was an ordained minister himself. He loved the Anglican church. He was a tutor at Oxford. He was a king-loving citizen of England. Tradition was his life. But from this point on, there's no stopping him. He becomes barred from many Anglican churches for this reputation he's gathering. And so he declares the world his parish, and he preaches wherever people would gather. This open-air preaching, which seemed so unnatural and so uncomfortable to him at first, spreads throughout England. Sometimes it is said that John Wesley preached to upwards of 20,000 people at a time by this method. Now let's remember that the Methodist movement began as a club. It had 4 people in it that were just praying together, called the Holy Club, when he was in college at Oxford. But when Wesley died in 1791, he left behind a movement with 72,000 members in the British Isles and 60,000 members in America. In his life, he rode over 250,000 miles to preach and teach this way. And in 2014, the last time a real census was taken, the United Methodist Church could claim over 80 million people worldwide. John Wesley did not set out to be credited as one of the most influential Christians in history, but he was so because he allowed God to work in ways that at the outset didn't make any sense to him. That in fact seemed antithetical to his work and his life and his traditions. The prejudices of his high church training, he had these strict notions of methods and proprieties for public worship. He understood very narrowly the apostolic succession and the prerogatives of a priest, what's allowed and what's not allowed. These were his most cherished convictions, things that he had been brought up knowing and loving. And not even these stood in his way eventually. He made himself more vulnerable in the cause of the gospel by being willing to lay down his traditions and face what was uncomfortable. He was changed. And his work expanded the kingdom of God in ways that are still unfolding in this church that bears his name. So I wonder again, am I willing to do the same? Am I willing to be changed by what makes me uncomfortable? Am I willing to part from my tradition for the sake of God's kingdom? As I ask myself those questions, I'm not sure where to start. I'm not as vivacious as that Canaanite woman, not as good maybe at initiating these sort of holy moments. But I will say this about this week. As I read this scripture and prayed over it, the news apps on my phone kept going off. And as I prayed in the morning and in the evening with my family, certain things kept creeping into our prayers. In the last couple of weeks, issues of race have bubbled up all over the place. Coming out of Charlottesville, Virginia, where an act of terrorism took the life of a young woman after a counter-protest to remove a Confederate statue turned violent. And for me, this is very uncomfortable. Issues of race make me very uncomfortable. To integrate conversations about race and about my privilege feel very unnatural to me. I'm not sure that I'm willing to give up certain traditions, which seem so important and rich to my country and my family and my church. I don't know what to say and do in the face of such complex realities. And so I'm guessing that these are exactly the issues and exactly the conversations which I need to have in order for the kingdom of God to be expanded. These are likely the issues in the conversations in which revolution is waiting, in which the kingdom of God will be revealed. I'll be praying this week. I'm probably going to some rallies and vigils because I'm trying to learn and listen. I'm trying to discern which of my traditions are holding back God's kingdom in this generation. Now, maybe this isn't the issue that's calling you. This is the issue that crept up in my prayers. Maybe conversations about race don't make you uncomfortable. I don't know what God is calling you to do. I don't know how God is calling you into deeper discipleship. But I think it's important for us to confess when we are struggling. And I'm struggling. But I pray for God to help me change in a way that is pleasing to his purpose and his mission. And this week, I encourage you to do the same. Struggle a little bit by asking yourself some hard questions, the questions that this Canaanite woman made Jesus ask himself. What traditions do I need to lay down? What issues feel unnatural and uncomfortable to me? And is it possible that an encounter with the unnatural and uncomfortable is exactly what I need to fulfill God's mission and purpose? I hope this week that we all have an uncomfortable encounter. And I pray that it changes us for the good of revolution and for the good of the gospel. Amen.